Now, joining me now to talk about this, Congressman Ron DeSantis of Florida. Congressman, thanks for being here. Just to give people a little bit of idea of who you are, you're a freshman, you were just elected, you were with the Navy, you were a JAG officer, and you represent the corner of Florida, the southeastern corner of Florida, Daytona Beach.
Northeastern.
I'm sorry, northeastern. I always get my directions wrong. Northeastern corner of Florida. But you're one of these unruly masses of Republican freshmen that are talked about all the time, that John Boehner so fears.
Well, first, thanks for having me on. I just would point out with the pay, I don't think we should get paid until this is resolved. And so I've asked the clerk to withhold any pay for me until we get this up and running. I just think that that's fair for the folks who've been negatively affected by this.
And, you know, and just to interrupt, that's one comment. I have a lot of veteran friends, as I know you do. One comment I hear all the time is, I defended my country, I'm a veteran, and now I don't get my benefits, but these guys who aren't doing the job they're supposed to do, they're getting paid.
Well, exactly. And so that's why, you know, I think we should do what I've done and lead by example. But then, too, we're going to move a VA funding bill today. There's certain things I think both parties can agree on. We've already moved a bill to fund the troops. That's went through the Senate, signed by the president. So let's take the ideas that we agree on. Let's just get those in there. There's no need to use this as political theater. But I will say, coming in, you know, our position was, look, we want to defund Obamacare. It's causing harm to our constituents. I understand why Democrats would balk at that. I mean, they voted for it. And then we said, okay, well, what about a one-year delay? Now, that's reasonable given the provisions that have already been delayed by the administration unilaterally. They said, no, no, no. So then we came back with, I think, what most Americans would think would be a very reasonable offer. Government funding, which you've agreed to, and then two provisions. One, we're going to stop these subsidies that are going to go to members of Congress that are not allowed under the Obamacare. It was basically engineered through OPM. Americans do not want to see that special treatment. And then a delay in the individual mandate, not because this is out of left field, but because the president has given one-year delays to employers and to insurance companies. And we actually got 22 Democrats in the House to support us on that in July. So I think most people would say you're not going to fund the government, U.S. Senate, because you're insisting on protecting the special deal for yourself and you're denying individuals the same break businesses are getting.
Let's unpack that, but first I want to look at it more broadly. You say you wanted to fund it, Obamacare, no. Then you want to delay Obamacare, no. Then you want to take these provisions. But the position of the president is, this is the law. It passed the House, it passed the Senate, I signed it into law. This is President Obama talking now. The Supreme Court right over there found it constitutional. So this isn't like a bargaining chip. This already is the law. You wanting to defund it or delay it or to chip away at it, that's you can debate that how you want, but you don't have the votes in this building, the Senate, to do that. So why, so this is an interesting strategy, but it's certainly not how things are normally done.
I think the president's argument would be a great argument if he was enforcing and implementing the law as written. The law that passed in 2010, and I think there was a lot of problems with that process, is not the same law that's being implemented. There are delays and waivers, and I think Americans look at this and they say, yeah, there are burdens imposed by this law, but if you're a business interest, you can get a delay. Members of Congress can go through OPM and get subsidies, and I do believe there will be a union carve-out at some point. I just think they know that's too hot right now.
I want to get to the thing about members of Congress, but before we do that, because I know that's something important that you and Senator Vitter here have worked on, but more broadly, the idea is you are taking this position against Obamacare. President Obama said today, millions of people are now going to have health insurance because of Obamacare. The exchanges are open. There are tens of millions of uninsured Americans who now will be able to go on this and shop around for affordable health care.
Well, I would say two things. One, we know millions of people are going to lose their employer-provided plans and get put in exchanges. CBO has acknowledged that. Some groups have looked at it, say it could be 20, 30 million. We know that there are people, if you're working 32, 33 hours a week, you may very well may lose some hours now because the incentives built into the law, you're seeing employers move people to part-time work. Mm-hmm. So there is harm being done to the average American, and we're just trying to mitigate some of that. And basically, the Senate's position is, no, we're not going to deal, we're not going to talk about that, full speed ahead.
Don't have a majority of the Senate. You don't have 60, I'm sorry. You don't have 50
votes. We don't have Republicans, but there were 80 senators that supported the repeal of the medical device tax. Joe Manchin and Democrats have indicated that this individual mandate delay would be reasonable.
I've heard one Senate Democrat, one.
And 22 House members, and then we had nine House members vote with us on the CR that we passed late last night as well.
Larger point is you don't have the votes in the Senate to achieve what you want to.
We don't have the votes to fully defund the law. I think we saw that play out.
I only have 1 minute, and I know you really want to talk about this provision about members of Congress and their staffs and a carve out. The issue that I've heard, and even the National Review takes this position, is you're actually treating members of Congress and their staffs differently than the rest of the public, because they are forced to go on the exchanges and then they don't get what, you know, for instance, Trader Joe's is doing and giving a $500 stipend for their workers. So what you're doing is, for low-level staffers here who make maybe $35,000 a year, you're basically taking $10,000 out of their paycheck.
So Obamacare took that out. Obamacare removed members of Congress and staff from the congressional system and put them into the exchanges. That's just the law. And the law does pinch them. There's no doubt about it. So the question is, if you want to get relief from that law, what's the proper way to do it? It's to go to Congress and ask to change the statute. Now, guys like me are going to balk at that because we want to give our constituents relief before we give people in the political class relief. But what you can't do is just have the executive branch make up subsidies and send it to you.
So do it legislatively.
You have a system where a private sector employee gets moved onto the exchanges, cannot receive a tax-excludable employee contribution. They can't. Members of Congress under this OPM rule would be able to get that. That treats them different than any other American in that similar circumstance.
We'll discuss this more in coming days. Congressman DeSantis, thanks so much for coming in. And thank you for your service. I appreciate it. When we come back,